To start our story, we go back to the time when cetaceans first appeared in the fossil record. But to know when cetaceans appear in the fossil record, we need to know what a cetacean is, or better put, how to tell if an animal is a cetacean. In other words, we need to know how to diagnose the clade cetacea. This is very important for understanding how fossil specimens are classified. In turn, this is itself critical for resolving phylogeny and for placing the appearance of specific characters in evolutionary history. The word cetacea refers to a taxonomic order, and originally it was defined by living whales and dolphins only. However, it has since been redefined to include the archaeocetes, or ancient whales, as well, many of which were only semi-aquatic. Whales and dolphins alive today fall into two suborders, Odontoceti and Mysticeti, the toothed whales and the baleen whales, respectively, and the term archaeocete refers simply to extinct members of cetacea that existed prior to the divergence of these two suborders. And note that it is a paraphyletic grouping. The key diagnostic characters of order cetacea are all in the skull region, and for illustrative purposes, here is a cat skull. Traits like the loss of hind limbs and a fully aquatic lifestyle are apomorphic in more derived clades within cetacea. One diagnostic character is that the auditory bullae, or the shell-like pockets of bone at the base of the skull that house the middle and inner ear structures, are very dense in cetaceans. In most mammals, the auditory bullae are very fragile and will often break when a skull is cleaned and prepared. But in cetaceans, the bone here is pachyosteosclerotic, which is just a fancy word that means dense bone tissue. In modern cetaceans, the auditory bullae are only attached to the rest of the skull by soft tissue. This is an adaptation that allows modern cetaceans to perceive directional sound underwater. But it also means that when cetacean skulls are prepared, you can actually hold the things. And even just doing that, you can feel how heavy they are relative to their size and compared to other bones in the cetacean skeleton. Another key feature of cetacean auditory bullae is the presence of a wave-shaped crest on the tympanic region. This crest is termed the sigmoid process. Its presence has aided in the classification of many important fossil discoveries. Some other diagnostic characters that are of particular importance in regard to archaeocetes include reentrant grooves on the front side of the lower molars. Reentrant grooves are infoldings of tooth enamel that make it better suited to grinding and shearing. Reentrant grooves can also be found on the molars of many ungulates and rodents. The presence of molars is a character state that has since been lost, and nearly all modern toothed cetaceans are homodont, meaning they have uniform, undifferentiated teeth. The canines and incisors of archaeocetes also line up with the cheek teeth. In other mammals, some canines and incisors are always found lining up on the front of the mouth. Take the human jaw as an example. Finally, archaeocetes are also distinguished by a temporal postorbital skull region that is very long and narrow, and in most mammals this is the area behind the nasal bones between the orbits or eye sockets. Now that we know how to diagnose a cetacean, we can delve into the fossil record. Cetaceans first appeared 53 to 54 million years ago in the early Eocene, and indeed the oldest fossil evidence for most of the modern orders of mammals is also from this time. Climate-wise, this was the start of a warming trend marked by a series of hypothermal periods, or periods of geologically rapid warming. The first of these was at the Paleocene-Eocene boundary and is known as the Paleocene-Eocene Thermal Maximum, or just PETM for short. The mean temperature of the Earth's surface rose by about 6 degrees Celsius during this period, and coincident with this temperature increase was a diversification and high turnover of mammalian taxa. Maximum temperatures during the Eocene were reached about 40 million years ago at the Middle Eocene climactic optimum. The earliest archaeocete fossils are from India and Pakistan, especially in the region of the Sulaiman Mountains, an area that was once the Tethys Sea before the Indian and Asian continents collided. The climate in this region at the time of the early Eocene was likely very hot and arid, making terrestrial sources of food scarce. The warming climate, in combination with shifting ocean currents caused by continental drift, by contrast, likely increased marine productivity in the Tethys Sea. This is important to keep in mind, as prey availability was likely a major influence or selective pressure on cetacean transition to increasingly aquatic lifestyles. The closest relatives to cetaceans were once thought to be a group of extinct ungulates or hooved mammals known as the mesonychids that originated in the Paleocene. This was originally proposed in the 1960s and was based on morphological similarities in the skull, particularly the teeth and cranium. Mesonychids were wolf-like in body plan and size, but had hooves. Their generally large jaws and modified molars suggest they were carnivorous and may have been the dominant predators of Paleocene Asia prior to the diversification of modern carnivore families. That the mesonychids and cetaceans were sister lineages was supported by other morphological studies incorporating more characters from the rest of the skeleton since then, and for a long time was a widely accepted hypothesis. The other hypothesis for the relationship of cetaceans to other mammals was that cetaceans were in fact nested within the taxonomic order known as Artiodactyla, the even-toed ungulates. This group includes animals like deer, cows, camels, pigs, and hippos. A relationship between cetaceans and artiodactyls was interestingly proposed as early as the 1800s, and this was based on shared soft tissue characteristics rather than anything related to the skeleton, particularly that both cetaceans and ruminants, like cows, have complex digestive tracts with multiple stomachs. But the main line of evidence for an origin of cetaceans within Artiodactyla was molecular. Phylogenies constructed based on DNA in the 1990s indicated that hippopotamids were, in fact, the closest living relatives to cetaceans. This would make Artiodactyla paraphyletic with respect to cetacea, since the term Artiodactyla would then refer to all living Artiodactyla and their common ancestor, but exclude a lineage of its descendants, the cetaceans. Those in support of an origin of cetaceans within Artiodactyla proposed a taxonomic revision and named a new grouping, Cetartiodactyla, that included both cetaceans and artiodactyls. This renaming was done to maintain monophyly in taxonomic nomenclature. The placement of cetacea within Artiodactyla was since supported by a wealth of DNA evidence, and also brought the placement of mesonychids into question. But the primary criticism that opponents of this artiodactyl origins hypothesis had was that phylogenies constructed based only on molecular characters exclude the fossil record, since, excepting in very rare cases, DNA cannot be extracted from fossils. The argument here is that by excluding fossil lineages for phylogenetic reconstruction, potentially important characters that reflect the true evolutionary relationships among living organisms will be missed, resulting in an inaccurate tree topology. None of this was helped by the confusion regarding hippopotamid origins at the time as well. Hippos were known to have derived from an extinct group called Anthracotheres, but the earliest Anthracotheres fossils were from the Oligocene, well after the divergence of cetaceans in the early Eocene. This big gap between the earliest known hippo ancestors and the earliest cetacean ancestors not only poorly supported the cetacean-hippo link proposed by molecular studies, but drew into question the placement of the hippo lineage. So what we have here is an awful lot of confusion and major disputes between morphological and molecular lines of evidence. All of this confusion could have been resolved with a simple piece of fossil evidence that was sadly at the time unavailable. A key diagnostic feature of artiodactyls is the shape of one of the ankle bones, called the astragalus. This bone articulates the foot with the shin bones, and here's a human foot just so you can see an example. In artiodactyls, it is grooved at both ends and termed double pulley as a result, a modification that is likely adaptive for running. Mesonychids, by contrast, have an astragalus that is grooved only at one end. Whether or not cetaceans originated within Artiodactyla or are a sister lineage to mesonychids would be resolved if the astragalus of an archaeocete could be found. Unfortunately, for a long time, the most distal bone in the hind limb that was preserved among discovered fossil archaeocetes was the femur, or thigh bone. So how will all this confusion be resolved? Did cetaceans originate in Artiodactyla, or are they indeed sister to the mesonychids? Where do hippos fit in? Keep watching this series to find out.